Papa bon Dieu, nous ka remercie ou pour tout ça que ou ka fait ban nous. Nous ka remercie ou pour permettre que nous nion moun kon Earl Bousquet à St.lucia qui ka porté information qui très important qui ka kebe moun à dans lumière pour yo comprendre plus meilleur ça qui ka fait dans les rôles là té là. Nous commande ou des béni nation là, nous commande ou des béni programme là, nous commande ou des béni tout ça qui ka fait dans la terre à dans l'intérêt moun qui pauvre. Nous commande ou assister nation qui en difficulté, nous commande ou protéger la terre là contre tout désastre qui ça fait, et nous commande ou aussi prolonger la vie Earl Bousquet qui c'est un homme exceptionnel que bon Dieu permette qu'il ni à dans St.lucia pour Caribbean là et pour Jean la terre là aussi. Merci papa bon Dieu pour tout. Béni programme là, béni ces moun là, béni hol la terre.
Bonjour, ça ka fait est ou bien. Bonjour, ça ka fait est ou bien. Bonjour, ça ka fait est ou bien. Moi ka souhaite ou en bonne journée. Bonjour, ça ka fait est ou bien. Bonjour, ça ka fait est ou bien. Bonjour, ça ka fait est ou bien. Moi ka souhaite ou en bonne journée.
Hello everyone, wherever you are, and welcome to the sixth edition of Earl at Large for 2023. Today, Sunday, the 30th day of April, the last of five Sundays in the month, and the last day of the fourth month of year 23 in century 21, which started on what we still call All a Fool's Day, but during which Christians here and across the world observed Lent, Muslims observed Ramadan, and Hindus observed Navratri, and the world also observed International Youth Month, Earth Day on the 22nd of April, and in the middle of the month, around the 15th, the Vatican renounced the 500-year-old doctrine of necessity, which was used by Columbus and those who came after him, with crosses on the sails of their boats, rosaries in their hands and around their necks, and swords and ammunition in their hands, to destroy civilizations, commit acts of mass genocide in the name of the Father, in the name of God. That doctrine, however, was renounced by Pope Francis in the middle of April 2022, after 500 years in existence. And that is a very significant action that has representation for all of the surviving people whose ascendants suffered from native genocide at the hands of Europeans. And that is why we're calling for reparations for slavery and native genocide. Bien bonjour tout le monde tout partout. Bonjour à tout, buenos dias à todos, ni hao. Et bon dimanche pour tout le monde tout partout qu'on nous dit qui a regardé nous, suivre nous aujourd'hui, c'est dernier dimanche et dernier jour. Un mois avril qui t'est commencé et jour nous ca cuire toujours poisson d'avril et dernier en 5 dimanche un mois Pâques et aussi mois international jeunesse mois international pour plusieurs d'autres bagages nous aussi célébrer journée internationale de la terre à ce 22 l'année ça là mois ça là avec aussi un mitamwa papla tiwe en vieux loi qui te ka baye l'Angleterre avec ce pays européen droit pour venir point ce petit pays ça là avec dit yo ka convert moun baye bon dieu pendant yo ka tue yo détruit civilisation yo avec tout ça en nom Jésus à bon parti qui ne croit Asumayo avec yoka tue moun avec chapelet l'homme yo avec en bas quoi Jésus avec quoi fait ça en nom bon Dieu pape là chef l'église catholique à sous la terre jodi a premier pape qui pas sorti Europe avec idi koran yoka renoncer ça avec sa significance pour nous st.lucia moun ki sa jwenn grand ayel yo c'était moun ki vini ici avant pardon avant africain avec avant indien so wherever you are here there and anywhere and everywhere it's our eighth year on air as we continue doing our best every Sunday to lighten, enlighten and entertain, share and reach out to you at home and abroad, in or out of town, in Castries or Beaufort, London or New York, Ontario or Toronto, Bridgetown or Georgetown, Queenstown or Kingstown, all the towns in Beaufort or Groseley, like I said, Soufre or Denry, or anywhere and everywhere in between, right here in sweet Ayanola. This is Earl at Large. And now for our usual reminder that Earl at Large Sunday cooking and lunchtime protocols are in place in your and our interest. So, as per usual, our house rules stand as advice for watching, which never changes. Nothing on fire anywhere, on your stove, in your oven, on your coal pot, or on your barbecue grill, in the kitchen or outside. Secondly, no lights or fans on in other rooms. Thirdly, all pipes closed tight. Fourthly, gates and vehicles locked. Fifthly, home phones off the hook. And number six, cell phones fully charged, on silent and on standby. And number seven, your remote control device put to rest. Yes, folks, that's your test as you forget all the rest and stay with the best from now till the end on Earl at Large. Give us your time and you won't regret today or any other Sunday. And here's how to follow Earl at Large live anytime and anywhere, every Sunday, at home or abroad, at work or at play.
Introducing a new way to follow your number one leader. The DBS St. Lucia app. View on the go your favorite DBS programming live. Never miss a newscast again. Be up to date with the latest news by tapping the Top Stories tab. Celebrate the life of a loved one at any time through the Obituaries tab. And if you've got a story for our news team, send us your news via our many mediums such as Gmail. Keep track of the weather with our 7-day forecast. it's even easier to view your number one leader with the all-new DBS St. Lucia app. Download today on the Google Play Store or Apple App Store. Visit our website at dbstvstlucia.com for more information.
We start with our usual words of wisdom and messages of inspiration from Monsignor Dr. Patrick Anthony Paba with Jesus Talk and Lucian Talk. Con la coutume, à nous commencer journée nous avec l'évangile pour aujourd'hui. Hod Monseigneur Dr. Patrick Anthony, nom nan nou ka kwe Paba, avec parole Jésus, avec parole St.lucia.
Welcome friends to Lucian Talk, Jesus Talk, with me, Paba. Lucian Talk. Pour ka gwate tellement itouve zomamai, which means the fowl scratches so much that it finds its mother's bones.
Bon Dieu, tata sio ki fè mwen atouen di dan telephone fiancé mwen, oui? Ou sav mwen pate prepare kon mwen pou révélation sa la? Ma goué sa se yon désappointment pou découvrir nom la se yon kwen nad. Mwen accepte, mwen ito, ek te two chiki. Sa pa te bon mes. De fe Hilda te toujou di, pou l ka gwate telman itouve zo mamay.
Jesus talk. Everything is worrisome beyond description. No matter how much we see, we are not satisfied. No matter how much we hear, we are not content. Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 8. Remember that as John Bellion says, sometimes the hole within our hearts is stupid deep. So from within your heart, be curious, not only about the things of the world, but especially about the things of heaven, the eternal things that endure.
And for those who missed the show last Sunday and the many who called to ask us to repeat by request, to encore, as old timers like me used to say, and one or two told me this week, in fact, one by the market said on Saturday, je vais là encore, banoua encore. So, here's a repeat of the good word from a hood in a New York church that we featured last week. Yes, folks, there is Coolio with Elvie and the New York Boys Choir on the Phil Donahue show with the number one hit. Yes, the number one hit from Coolio's album entitled Dangerous Minds. Blessings to you.
Hey there, folks. Ladies and gentlemen, my next guest tonight is with us to perform the number one song in the country, which appears on the number one album in the country, the soundtrack to the movie Dangerous Minds. Folks, it's a real pleasure to welcome, along with LV and the New York Boys Choir, Coolio.
Yeah. New York Boys Choir in the house. LV in the house. Check it out. As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I take a look at my life and realize there's nothing left. Cause I've been blasting and laughing so long that even my mama thinks that my mind is gone. But I ain't never crossed a man that didn't deserve it. Me be treated like a punk, you know that's unheard of. You better watch how you're talking and where you're walking, or you and your homies might be lying to Chuck. I really hate the trip, but I gotta low. As they croak, I see myself in the pistol smoke. Fool, I'm the kind of G the little homies wanna be, like on my knees in the night, saying prayers in the street light.
Been spending most of my lives living in the gangster's paradise. Been spending most of my lives living in the gangster's paradise. Keep spending most of my lives living in the gangster's paradise. Keep spending most of my lives living in the gangster's paradise.
situation they got me facing. I can't live a normal life, I was raised by the state, so I gotta be there with the hood team. Too much television watching got me chasing dreams. I'm an educated fool with money on my mind, Mac-10 in my hand and a gleam in my eye. I'm a loped out gangster, set tripping banger, and my homies is down, so don't arouse my anger. Fool, death ain't nothing but a heartbeat away. I'm living life do or die. What can I say? I'm 23 now, but will I live to see 24? The way things is going, I don't know.
Tell me why are we so blind to see that the ones we hurt are you?
But I don't know what's cooking. They say I got to learn, but nobody's here to teach me. If they can't understand it, how can they reach me? I guess they can't, I guess they won't, I guess they front. That's why I got my hand on the pump, fool.
Been spending most of my lives living in the gangster's paradise. Been spending most of my lives living in the gangster's paradise. Keep spending most of my lives living in the gangster's paradise. Keep spending most of my lives living in the gangster's paradise. Tell me, why are we so blind to see?
I don't know.
The ones we hurt are you and me.
I don't know.
Why are we so blind?
Oui, man, Coolio avec Elvi en balaté, pani, plaisir. C'est ça qui a fait nous changer là. En balaté, pani, plaisir. Yes, folks, a reminder of last Sunday's reminder that tomorrow isn't ours and there isn't life after death in what we might think is a gangster's paradise in heaven. Now for today's program highlights. Of course, as per usual, we look at what's happened everywhere in the past week and put it all into context. And we'll also tell you what's coming up for Jazz and Carnival, and we'll have the updates on reparations and emancipation, the upcoming coronation of King Charles next week. And of course, today being the last day of Youth Month 2023, we'll also look at some youth issues as well, and we'll feature some special youth talent from elsewhere that we can and should also have here, if only we know that we can do it and we give it a try. And on the not so joyful side today, two global figures in entertainment died this week. Two great performers, 2 days apart, and we'll remember both. Not only today, but in time to come. Alors, nous kaye ba ou tout bagay, nous semble ba ou en semaine la ki passe ya, sorti ici en Caraïbes et aussi Oliwon Latea. This is Earl at Large. Ça c'est Earl à Guacon. Lots happened here in the past week, and while much focus was on the latest violent deaths, Prime Minister Philip J. Pierre was putting the final touches to and eventually presented his $1.5 billion budget on last Tuesday, the 25th of April. And what a budget it was, attracting mainly positive comments from neutral and objective persons, most who gave Prime Minister Pierre big pats on the back, and many saying this is the most they've seen any government deliver in less than 2 years on the job after independence, especially in these trying circumstances. We will also bring you some budget highlights later, but for now, let's look at some other issues in the news in the last week of April 2023. Now, with Jazz and Arts, the Jazz and Arts Festival that is less than a week away, and all roads leading to the traditional venues at Groseley after opening night at Mindo Philip Park next weekend, activities are also planned for Dariso, with fusions of jazz and quail, jazz and arts, plus reggae, calypso, hip-hop, gospel, tut bagay. Young St. Lucians folks also this week took to the jazz stage in Castries, while the performers, the singers, and the players of instruments and logistical personnel, caterers, and other service providers prepare for what's expected to be yet another successful jazz festival, including a new feature of pan and jazz. Yes, steel bands and pan players to exhibit the pleasure of pan for jazz. In other local news this past week, Carnival 23 was also launched at the Sandals Grand week before, following the Uber Cruise curtain raiser in Port Castries at Point Serafin 2 weeks ago, with promises this past week that Mass 2K23 will be much bigger, much better, and with no less than a dozen Juve bands, more adults and kiddies carnival bands, and of course, more steel bands as well. April also being observed internationally and regionally as Youth Month, young people did almost everything here. The Youth Economy Agency, or the Agency for the Youth Economy, was launched, and six young entrepreneurs have received funding for micro, small, and medium-sized enterprises, what we call MSMEs, with another 70 applications being considered as we speak, and over 7,000 inquiries at the agency's website. And with the applications for grants and loans coming in so fast and furious, the deadline, we've been made to understand, and it has been advertised, the deadline for applications has now been extended until the end of May. And of course, more carnival and jazz news, with carnival and jazz coming up, carnival in May. Jazz in May and Carnival in July. The chair of the Eastern Caribbean Copyright Organization, David Jordan, is calling for early dialogue between performers and those who use their music, most often without acknowledging their copyrights. What we call copyright is the rights of those who wrote the original copy to get their compensation for giving us the joy of listening to, reading, or watching what they had to work their brains to put together in the first copy that we continue to see for the rest of our lives. after that little lesson in copyright. The ECCO, ECHO, the chair of ECHO, Mr. Jordan, and his directors are also planning to widen the regional entities' representation, yes, across the island, across all the islands, across here and across the OECS, while also taking steps eventually to reach those engaged in the creative industries outside of just music, including young innovators, to convince them of the value to their pockets and to their future of membership and representation by ECHO. And more youth news this past week. Youth representing Team St. Lucia in sports made the island proud abroad in cricket and athletics in this youth month that ends today. And of course, the Boys Training Center and the New Transit Home joined the Alliance Française to embrace mural art, painting murals outside the pyramid at Point Serafin, providing positive outlets for youth in isolation. And of course, youth and students, more youth news. At the end of Youth Month, youth and students also participated this past week or in the week ending today or last night or yesterday. There's always confusion as to when the week ends, whether it's on Saturday or Sunday or in between at midnight between Saturday and Sunday. Anyway, Library Week has just ended from last Sunday, April the 23rd, to yesterday, Saturday, April 29th, and that included book exhibitions and various other activities aimed at encouraging reading. Yes, encouraging us, young and old, and in between, to read and not let Google fully replace our libraries, especially as it has been established that as information technology, IT, as information technology advances, less people are reading books and newspapers and magazines that are printed. Many, too many in my view, opting to allow e-books to read themselves to them, leading to closure, as we have seen in St. Lucia and around the world, of traditional bookshops where you could have gone to buy a novel, a classic, or a storybook. That's the way of the world today, but then being able to read is still absolutely essential, folks, even to start to understand information technology. And now, in observance of the end of Youth Week 2023, we offer the following music videos featuring young people, children actually, in Africa, like children here and across the Caribbean, demonstrating their talents and their consciousness at early ages of the talents they have. And we are presenting this world famous children's musical group here on Earl at Large. We've done it many times before, starting in 2019 and continuing in 2020. Today, here are some updates from the Masaka Kids. Love it up, folks. Millie.
Can be a better place if started to care and stop being selfish in what we do. So brother, we got to move together. Sister, we got to fight together. Together we I look to you. In the darkest hour, I look to you. In the time of trouble, you bring me hope and wash my tears away. I look to you, my friend, you the meaning of love. Just like you look at someone, someone looks up to you, and they have the one quality to acquire. So friend, when I'm tired and weak, you're raised on my mind. Together we're strong, my friend, that's the meaning of love. I look to you. In the darkest hour, I look to you. In the time of trouble, you bring me away. I look to you, my friend, you the meaning of love. You and me can make life better. Beautiful world when we come together. You and me can make life better. Beautiful world when we come together. I look to you. In the darkest hour, I look to you. In the time of trouble, you bring me home. Away. I look to you, my friend, you the meaning of love. I look to you. In the darkest hour, I look to you. In the time of trouble, you bring me hope and wash my tears away. I look to you, my friend, you the meaning of love.
Hello?
Champion!
Masaka Kids!
Hey, hey.
Africana! Now Sobola, together as one. Fight to Sembela, divided we fall. Together we rise, no one can put me down. I wanna be a champion. I need a better tomorrow.
Yes, I'm a champion.
No retreat, no surrender.
I wanna be a champion.
I need a better tomorrow.
Yes, I'm a champion.
No retreat, no surrender.
Surrender.
I need a better tomorrow.
Yes, I'm a champion.
Those of you watching Earl at Large long enough will remember they massacred kids much earlier. Now they're back, and of course, well, where else are you going to get it but on Earl at Large? And to continue with our local review from the past week, folks, two entities observed their 30th anniversaries in St. Lucia this past week. A Center for Adolescent, Center for Adolescent Renewal and Education Care. Center for Adolescent Renewal and Education, CARE, has spent 3 decades caring for youth and students needing special forms of attention. And of course, Sandals Resorts International Executive Chairman Adam Stewart this week also thanked Prime Minister Philippe J. Pierre for his congratulations on Sandals' 30-year milestone being observed with 3 hotels, 4 properties, including an international golf course, and over 2,000 St. Lucians employed, and the company paying, or should I say the chain, paying on their behalf over 260,000 EC dollars in taxes annually to the National Treasury, which is over 100,000 US dollars annually. And on the agriculture front this past week, Commerce Minister Emma Hippolyte told Parliament and the nation, and we're telling you through here, that according to her, it will no longer be business as usual with cannabis now that the related legislation has been passed. Let me repeat that. The Minister of Commerce, Emma Hippolyte, has told Parliament and the nation that it will no longer be business as usual with cannabis now that the related legislation has been passed. The minister says cannabis-related investments from today will move on from illegal marijuana sales to legitimate businesses involving cannabis products. And also in agriculture this past week, the CMOS farmers at Opicon in Beaufort North also got assistance from Export St. Lucia, and what they got was 60 drying tables and many floating devices. And also the Ministry of Agriculture hosted another fish food fiesta on Friday, this past Friday, day before yesterday, at the Castries Fishing Complex, organized again by Sydney Present, Sydney Present, te kaweste mash, en Sydney Lane, some tevle kouye vini hale pie mwen. Sorry. Sorry, Sydney. The food festival, this year's fish food festival took place on Friday at the fishing complex in Tougagnier, Castries. Yes, Tougagnier, that's what it used to be called once upon a time. And on the health front, Acting Governor General Errol Charles has indicated that the government will continue subsidizing essential goods for vulnerable people, while the Prime Minister has assured that new taxes and levies for health and crime won't apply to food, and that social services, as he pointed out in the budget, have all got financial improvements from the distress fund to the public assistance program, while the Pan American Health Organization, PAHO, donated equipment as well to the Ministry of Health. And in other health news this past week, Dr. Merle Clark was re-elected head of the Medical and Dental Association. Also this past week, folks, Prime Minister Philippe J. Pierre thanked Taiwan for its continuing assistance to St. Lucia, including 7,000 IT devices for students and contributing to the youth economy agency, providing drones as well for police and scanners for customs, and as important, providing help for housing and $18.5 million for the constituency development program. And folks, that's not all. The Prime Minister also put Taiwan on notice that St. Lucia will definitely want more, especially in these times when we need every bit of help that we can get from everywhere. And as promised, folks, here are the following videos of youth taking the stage for jazz, and two brief budget reports, a reminder that jazz is around the corner, and where you can go next Sunday evening in Castries.
Wednesday saw the official launch of the Junior Jazz and Arts Festival at the Sandals Halcyon Beach Resort. The initiative, spearheaded by the Castries Constituency Council in collaboration with the Ministry of Housing and Local Government and the Ministry of Youth Development and Sports, promises a stellar showcase of youth talent in various cultural and creative art forms. During a welcome remarks, Mayor for Castries Geraldine Lendo Gabriel gave a brief history of the conceptualization of the event. She says various meetings leading up to the occasion sparked enormous ideas that would direct and shape the overall atmosphere for the Junior Jazz and Arts Festival. She revealed that one of these ideas led to a partnership that would see the event broadcast in 88 countries around the globe.
I spoke to an agency in the US, a radio station in the US, which says that they will be doing that. They actually broadcast in 88 countries and they're preparing to carry the event live. So we're moving our people from being on that stage from this point in time to hitting the world very, very easily.
Dove Productions has been instrumental in providing various opportunities for the growth of youth talent here in St. Lucia. The company, for a few years now, has held its Caribbean Youth Film Festival, which has added to the crop of media professionals on the island. Dove Productions is one of the main partners for the inaugural Junior Jazz and Arts Festival, and its representative, Kimberly Peters, says the company is thankful for the opportunity to further impact the St. Lucian youth.
We are pleased that this coming together for the youth brought together a collective of like-minded people and with determination to establish a platform and provide an outlet where our youth can shine. They deserve it.
Music coordinator Shirley-Ann Cyril Myers says the festival provides an opportunity for the talents of the island's youth to be nurtured. She further emphasized that it provides a unique opportunity to tackle some of the bigger issues facing youth at this time.
Our aim is to make changes in the lives of our youth, as would by extension impact our nation for the best. Despite all the social ills increasing at such a rapid pace, eroding the very fabric of our society and the values that have kept us, we applaud the Castries Constituency Council and all stakeholders for this wonderful initiative to help showcase the talents of the youth.
Local Government Minister Richard Frederick, during his feature address, highlighted the government's exploits in providing a more accommodating landscape for the island's youth. He remains hopeful that participants of this year's Junior Jazz and Arts Festival can soar to even greater heights.
In keeping with what is currently transpiring in this country around this time, the jazz time, we felt it necessary that the youth of this country be permitted to showcase their talent. And in that regard, the Junior Jazz Festival was born. It is an opportunity provided to the young people of this country to showcase their talent and to build on that talent henceforth. They will emanate from the schools, from the graduates, and even from the inner cities of this country. No young person should be left out. Artists can display their paintings, and whatever talent you believe you need to showcase, the opportunity is at hand.
The inaugural Junior Jazz and Arts Festival will be held on May 11th and 12th at Serenity Park in Castries from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. The lineup for the event will be announced soon. For the DBS News World, Jason Darius reporting.
For his second budget as Prime Minister, Honorable Philippe J. Pierre and his cabinet of ministers have crafted policies that would build on the socio-economic gains of 2022-2023 and also inspire positive economic trends throughout the 2023-2024 financial year.
We as a country have good reasons to celebrate because of the economic gains we have made, notwithstanding the external challenges and concerns about citizen security.
St. Lucia's post-COVID economic health continues to move from strength to strength under Prime Minister Pierre's stewardship. For the second consecutive fiscal year, St. Lucia is on course to register double-digit GDP growth of 18.1% in 2022, a marked improvement when compared to the 12.1% GDP projection in the previous year. Prime Minister Pierre has successfully nursed St. Lucia's economy from the sharpest GDP decline to the second best performing economy in the entire CARICOM region since assuming office mid-year 2021. The key economic indicators are trending in the right direction as a result.
Guyana, St. Lucia, and Barbados recorded the highest growth rates, and St. Lucia recorded the second highest growth rate after Guyana.
For the first time since 2010, the national unemployment rate dropped to 19% by the end of 2022, and youth unemployment declined to its lowest levels in 13 years.
We remain committed to driving overall unemployment, and in particular, youth unemployment down to single digits before the end of this parliamentary term.
The overall deficit has been slashed from $287 million in 2021 to a projected $17.3 million by the end of 2023. Following three consecutive years of deficits, the primary balance returned to a surplus of $82.4 million. The current balance has improved from a deficit of $139.1 million to a surplus of $12.6 million in 2023. The debt-to-GDP ratio is down to 69.8% in 2022 from a high of 85.9% in 2021. The government has directed resources derived from the economic gains of the previous year to ensure local vulnerable populations receive additional support. A further $5 million has been injected into the public assistance program, increasing the allocation to $25.9 million. The St. Lucia Social Development Fund has distributed more than $17 million in social intervention programs. $7 million has been allocated to the home care program to secure care for the elderly. An additional $10 million has been allocated to the Ministry of Equity to provide social assistance to the island's needy.
Our economic policies go beyond revenue generation and are also intended to assist those who justly and deservedly require assistance.
The average St. Lucian household also benefited from financial interventions at the behest of the Prime Minister and his cabinet. The government spent $40 million to subsidize LPG cooking gas in 2022. $8.9 million in tax refunds have been paid out to date. $18.3 million in outstanding back pay was disbursed to public servants during the fiscal year. Government pensioners each received a one-off payment of $500 last year. At least 10,000 public and private sector workers will be exempted from paying income tax this year. And NIC pensioners currently enjoy a 4.2% increase on their monthly payments. More relief measures will be implemented in the coming months.
I propose the following: a rebate of $1 per gallon on fuel for all registered fishers. A one-off payment of $600 for government pensioners, payable in November 2023. A $600 increase in the one-time allowance to teachers, bringing the amount to $1,100. An extension of duty rebate on vehicles which are available to frontline workers during COVID-19 to customs and correctional officers. I propose, Mr. Speaker, a one-year window for the local purchase or import of these vehicles, which will end in July 2024.
The strategic choices comprised in Prime Minister Pierre's 2023-2024 budget is designed to respond to the challenges confronting St. Lucia, with the aim of securing a better life for its citizens and inhabitants. The strategic choices for the 2023-2024 budget will target health, national security, and economic sustainability. From the Office of the Prime Minister, Rihanna Izudo.
Starting from July 1st, 2023, we shall impose a health and security levy of 2.5% on goods and services.
In an effort to maintain the gains made in the economy and to stimulate further economic growth, the Prime Minister has proposed the introduction of a health and security levy. The new 2.5% levy will be applied on goods and services except food items, medicines, selected building materials, and medical and security equipment. While this levy bears similarities to the value-added tax, which is currently being applied at 12.5% on goods and services, the revenue generated from it will be used specifically to finance the health and security needs of the nation. The government has projected that some $33 million will be raised through this levy. The Prime Minister has stressed that the health and security levy will be implemented to have a minimum inflationary impact, especially on the cost of food.
Let me be very clear. This levy will not be imposed on any food items. Let me be clear. This levy will not be imposed on any food items. Nous pas qu'à mettre pièce levy à sous manger. This levy will not be imposed on any food items. This means, Mr. Speaker, that the cost of food should not change because of the levy, unless prices increase from overseas.
The new tax will also be executed to avoid any additional administrative burden and cost to businesses, says the Prime Minister.
I am urging the private sector to work with the government to ensure that this measure is not used as a basis for increasing the price of food. We expect, Mr. Speaker, that as freight charges come down, food prices and other imported items prices will also decrease.
In addition to the new levy, the Prime Minister also announced the suspension of VAT on select building materials for a period of 2 years, with the expectation of stimulating activity in the housing and construction sector.
Plywood, lumber, steel, cement, and galvanized. (Clears throat) This means, Mr. Speaker, that the retail price of these items should be reduced by 12.5% unless the imported price of these changes increase.
To ensure businesses comply with the new levy and the VAT removal on the building materials, the government will engage in a price monitoring exercise, says the Prime Minister. Meanwhile, excise tax on tobacco products will be increased by 50% from May 21st, 2023. For the DBS News World, I am Zane Romulus.
Get ready to witness the biggest names in Caribbean music. Join us on May 5th for the opening of St. Lucia Jazz and Arts Festival 2023. Back at the historic Mindo Philip Park, located in the heart of Castries. Experience the explosive performance of Kes the Band, the biggest soca band in the world.
And I feel like I just win the million.
Get ready to witness the unstoppable force that is Shensia as she performs hit after hit.
Baby, when the bright lights start to fade,
hit after hit.
You can't tell me what you do.
And move to the rhythms of DYP and Friends. If you purchase your tickets before March 31st, you can take advantage of our early bird discount and pay only 54 EC for general admission. Visit stlucia.org/jazz to purchase your tickets. The St. Lucia Jazz and Arts Festival 2023.
Do you want to live forever?
A little folktale, a bizarre tale of love.
Patcher, I...
Betrayal.
Never step foot in my house.
And the supernatural. Sunday, 7th May, 7:30 p.m. Admission, $50 EC or $15. Monday, 8th May, school's matinee, 11 a.m. Admission, $20 EC or $8 at the National Cultural Center.
Welcome back to our review of this past week. And in Caribbean developments, this time, those we did cover, we can tell you that CARICOM leaders declared war on guns and gangs in Trinidad and Tobago last week, just as the country was named as having the sixth highest crime rate in the world, followed by Guyana at number 7 and Jamaica at number 10. But with all eyes on St. Lucia and also recognizing their turn is never far away, the Caribbean leaders also decided this time to go to the root of the matter and to try to nip gun crime in the butt. The CARICOM leaders put the blame for the state of gun crime across the Caribbean today, where that blame should be. And that is where it belongs. And that is telling the United States that it needs to start to be seen and to be felt, to be doing much more to reduce the number of increasingly high caliber weapons being allowed to leave US borders and tracked to the Caribbean. Washington, the United States, got Caribbean leaders' top support across the region for its decades-long war on drugs. Our jails ended up being filled with young people for being caught with marijuana, because after independence, all of the CARICOM former British colonies were made to put marijuana as a dangerous drug on the books alongside cigarettes and alcohol, leading to, like I said, our jail here and others around the world, but particularly around the region, being filled by young people overcrowding our jails. We did that to give support to the United States war on drugs, because they claimed that the marijuana was coming from the islands into the United States. Now the reverse is on today. The U.S. seems more interested in tracing the routes being used to traffic illegal drugs and guns out of America into the Caribbean, and not necessarily in helping the Caribbean to address and reduce the effects of those drugs, those really dangerous drugs, and those really dangerous high-caliber weapons, all of which are made in America and being used in our region to take lives by day and night across the entire Caribbean and Latin America. Meanwhile, notorious gang members in Haiti this past week have started feeling the backlash from a public that's had enough, with several members of one of several city gangs cornered and killed on the spot after being cornered by a large crowd of hostile citizens in Port-au-Prince, fed up with gangs controlling 80% of their city, with schools, businesses, and public entities, including overwhelmed hospitals, inaccessible or mainly closed, while the government of Haiti in exile in its own country is appealing for external help with not much assistance and not many offers, folks. Meanwhile, Guyana continues to grow as the region's strongest economy, which grew by 37.5% in 2022, and it continues on an upward trajectory, while St. Lucia grew by 18.1%, outstripping Barbados as the best performing non-oil-based economy in CARICOM. I repeat, St. Lucia grew by 18.1%, outstripping Barbados as the best performing non-oil-based economy in CARICOM and the OECS last year. So folks, Guyana and St. Lucia continue to lead the pace like the bulls and the horses in Guyana's annual rodeo held in Rupununi savannas, where you'll find real cowboys and Indians. But don't just take it from me. See for yourself in this brief video from Euro News.
All right, Ita Pava, if you heard about Ita Pava,
this is very, very dangerous. We're the wild out of the robin. Yes, please.
And from Guyana's Rupununi savannas, here's where we hit the world stage, where so much happened this past week, from the new war in Sudan to the old war in Ukraine, more reaction to China as a peacemaker between Ukraine and Russia, from the looks of what seems to be a return to Cold War times in the South China Sea and the Korean Peninsula, to a mixture of good and bad news from Buckingham Palace and Downing Street in London about slavery and reparations. And of course, we will share and celebrate the brighter sides of some very bad news, some very bad and sorrowful news from America's entertainment world for people the world over. But folks, let's start with the mixed news from Britain, where King Charles is getting ready to wear the crown and sit on the throne His mother sat on for 70 years, and the crown she wore on her head for 70 years at Buckingham Palace. And he will be doing it for the first time, not yet, but next week. But for now, Prince Charles, now King Charles, is under pressure already to clean up Buckingham Palace's dirty slavery record. He was called upon in the past week to do better than his mother, Queen Elizabeth II, and actually apologize for slavery instead of offering expressions of royal sorrow. And the new king is also being called upon by a new group of United Kingdom citizens and loyal subjects of his crown called Heirs of Slavery to not only apologize, but to also engage with the 14 CARICOM leaders who requested dialogue on slavery and native genocide with Britain and the European Union since way back in November 2013, but who are still awaiting a response all of a decade later in 2023. London's Guardian newspaper recently exposed as having deep slavery links earlier this month. And last week it called on the king to admit the royal family was also involved in slavery, something no one will ever have reason to doubt. The king disclosed in response to The Guardian that he had commissioned way back in October of last year research into the royal palace and the royal family's links to slavery. And he said, for all Brits and for the world to hear, that he is also inclined, before he takes the throne, to start discussing reparations. The fact is, folks, and I keep saying this, the royal family has been smelling the coffee for some time now and has realized from the time the Queen was still alive, a year before she died, when she made three royal expressions of sorrow for slavery in the Caribbean and in Africa. The royal family has been smelling the coffee for some time now, and they have realized that the reparations issue is no longer a little cup of tea, as more United Kingdom citizens feel that Buckingham Palace has a race problem and that Prince Charles, now King Charles, thanks to his persona, can fix it. So the debate is still raging in the United Kingdom Parliament, for example, where this past week, two parliamentarians, one government and one opposition, were suspended for expressing opposite views on slavery. The white conservative member of parliament saying that every British citizen should have a slave today in 2023, and the black Labour MP saying that racism is nothing new to the United Kingdom. And folks, both were made to apologize, but the United Kingdom government and the parliament are still both ducking the reparations issue. Europe is getting more divided on reparations, with the Netherlands, formerly called Holland, making an apology last December. And Portugal's president this past week said his country should pay reparations for slavery, because we have to remember Portugal played a very important and decisive role in opening the routes to slavery. But the United Kingdom, France, and other European nations that built empires as well off slavery are simply refusing to recognize this reality. Indeed, every United Kingdom Prime Minister since 2013, from David Cameron come right up to the present Rishi Sunak, have refused to apologize for slavery, no matter where they come from. They have all refused, and no matter which party they came from, they all refused to apologize for slavery. And the current prime minister, like I said, Rishi Sunak, is no different. As he told a black United Kingdom MP just this past week, a black United Kingdom MP, equal citizen like him, called on him this past week to say something and maybe apologize. Say what is the British government's position on slavery under him as the son of immigrants who came to Britain in the 20th century. So here was the black MP of African heritage calling on the Prime Minister of England of Indian heritage to say something and maybe apologize for slavery. Well, don't take it from me. See and hear for yourself what Prime Minister Rishi Sunak had to say in response. Take it for yourself.
This month marks 23 years since the passing of the late, great Bernie Grant, a former member of this House and the founder of the UK reparations movement in the UK. In his last Prime Minister's questions before his death, he asked for an apology to the people of African descent, living and dead, for our country's role in slavery and colonialism. But since then, Prime Ministers and heads of state have only ever expressed sorrow or deep regret. These are not sentiments that are befitting one of the greatest atrocities in human history. And there's been no acknowledgement of the wealth that has been amassed or the fact that our country took out the largest loan it ever has to pay off the slave owners and not the enslaved. So I want to ask the Prime Minister today if he will do what Bernie Grant asked all those years ago, what I have asked and what countless others have asked since, and offer a full and meaningful apology for our country's role in slavery and colonialism and commit to reparatory justice.
Minister.
No, Mr. Speaker, that what I think our focus should now be on doing is, of course, understanding our history in all its parts, not running away from it, but right now making sure that we have a society which is inclusive and tolerant of people from all backgrounds. That's something that we on this house, our side of the house, are committed to doing and will continue to deliver, but trying to unpick our history is not the right way forward and is not something that we will focus our energies on.
Meanwhile, folks, King Charles is spending his last week without his crown from today until this coming Saturday, the 6th of May, when he'll also sit on what used to be his mother's throne for the first time after a coronation ceremony that no one on earth has seen since 1952, 71 years ago, when his mother, Queen Elizabeth II, was crowned at less than half his age. We will also be taking you through those eventualities in video. But the question is, will the King apologize? Will Buckingham Palace pay reparations for slavery? Will King Charles convince the United Kingdom government to apologize and pay reparations for slavery and native genocide? We'll never know until the new king makes his older but hopefully wiser mind up. Whatever he decides, we will know earlier than later. But either way, Buckingham Palace and the United Kingdom government cannot escape the judgment of British citizens and of the world community, but particularly of British citizens, more and more of who are supporting calls for reparatory justice, including today's heirs and successors of British slave owners and traders. But folks, if you thought it was only in England or the United Kingdom, England, Ireland, Scotland, and Wales, that the pressure is up for reparations, not so. As across the Atlantic Ocean in the United States, the pressure is also mounting. African Americans never stopped demanding reparations since George Floyd died and the Black Lives Matter movement was born in 2020. And you will recall that reparations was on the agenda for the US presidential election campaign in 2020. And it will be again next year for 2024. But like in the United Kingdom, there is also mounting pressure in America from those who oppose reparations for African Americans, like Dr. Phil, the popular TV doctor we all know, who said last week that it will be an absolute disaster if America was to give over $300,000, which is the estimate that would go to every American for reparations, every American who can trace his or her ancestry to slavery and to the slave trade. Each will get over $300,000 if reparations is given, which the United States can easily afford. Dr. Phil, however, says it would be an absolute disaster if America was to give over $300,000 to every black man as reparations compensation for the African ancestors being enslaved in America. And why? Because according to him, they will spend it out too fast, too quick, too fast, too furious. But that's not his business. What they do with it is theirs. Their ancestors paid in blood, sweat, and tears for it. And not because it is black people. He also said that white people would do the same. Mais ça pas à faire, Dr. Phil, toi indisqué. Okay? So if America, under President Biden, or under Vice President Kamala Harris, should she ever become president for whatever reason, should America agree to address reparations like Biden had agreed to in 2021, when in January, just as the Martin Luther King celebration birthday was approaching, Donald Trump unleashed his supportive volunteer troops to take over the Capitol. Not the Capitol, the Capitol. Capitolio. It's Capitol from the word Capitolio. And that was used, I wouldn't say as an excuse, but as the reason for not delivering on the reparations promises that were made by all of the 9 Democratic candidates for the nomination for the presidency for the 2020 elections campaign. Presidential elections are coming again in November of 2024, and most likely it will be Donald Trump again against Joe Biden. If Donald Trump doesn't get jailed with one of those so many cases around him, and again reparations will be in the campaign, and again another January is going to come next year. And should the Democrats be elected, that is where the reparations issue will again come to the fore for Martin Luther King's birthday in 2024. In the meantime, let's look at some of the other things that happened last week. And in the United States as well, the big story, folks, the other big story in America that did not make the headlines was that Don Lemon was fired from CNN. Yes, folks, in case you didn't know, you've just heard it. Don Lemon was fired from CNN after telling a senior non-white Republican Party official on air on CNN one morning that the Republican Party official's account of the history of treatment of black people in America after the Civil War was wrong. Yes, folks, in case you didn't know, Don Lemon is no longer at CNN. and he wasn't even told that he was fired. They called his agent to tell his agent to tell him he's fired. And he let it be known on Instagram that he didn't even know. He was dismissed from a station he had given 17 years of his life. And up to now, no reason has been given why Don Lemon was fired at CNN. But here's more from someone who knows more about it. And I'm talking about Roland Martin, who also worked at CNN.
People are talking about the firing of Tucker Carlson. Then Don Lemon gets fired at CNN. All right? So he's been on thin ice because supposedly back and forth with Caitlin Collins and Poppy Harlow. Of course, John Malone made clear when Discovery took over that he wanted them to be a little bit different, more like Fox News in the reporting. Chris Licht has made it clear he wants the network to attract more conservatives. He wants them to be more down the middle, less rancor, all that sort of stuff. Then the folks at the New York Times, they are saying that this interview last week with the Republican nominee for president, who's Indian American, this played a role in Don getting fired. Listen to the interview.
Due respect, I find your explanation reductive and actually insulting, including to Black Americans, to say that Black people today, compared to 1964, 1865, haven't made progress in part because of the freedoms we secured. And the Second Amendment was
black
part
people,
of
wait, hold, hang on,
that
please.
Freedom.
I cannot keep a thought if you guys are talking to me in my ear. So hang on one second. So to say that Black people, say what you said again.
Black people secured their freedoms after the Civil War. It is a historical fact, Don. Just study it. Only after their Second Amendment rights were secured.
They were not secured their freedoms after the Civil War. That is not, you are discounting Reconstruction. You're discounting a whole host of things that happened after the Civil War when it comes to African Americans, including the whole reason that the Civil Rights Movement happened is because Black people did not secure their freedoms after the Civil War, and that things turned around. People tried to change the freedoms that were supposed to happen.
And you know how they got
it?
They got their Second Amendment rights, and they actually got, the NRA played a big role in that. But today, Don, the
NRA did not play a big role.
They trained Black Americans how to use firearms.
That's a lie. That's not. The NRA did not play a big role.
This is just historical fact.
It's not a historical fact.
The part that I find,
because you say it's a historical fact,
the part that I find insulting is when you say today Black Americans don't have those rights after we have gone through
the
civil rights revolution in this country.
You are sitting here telling an African American about the rights and what you find insulting about the way I live, the skin I live in every day.
Here's where you and I have a different point of view.
Black and white, that Black people don't have in this country, and that Black people do have.
Well, here's where you and I have a different point of view. I think we should be able to express our views regardless of the color of our skin. We should have this debate without me regarding
views,
you as a Black man, but me regarding
here,
you as a fellow citizen.
That you're
That's
sitting
what I think
here,
we should say.
Whatever ethnicity you are, explaining to me
whatever ethnicity
about
I'm,
what
tell
it's like to be Black.
Whatever
America.
Ethnicity
I'm
I am,
sorry.
I'll tell you what I am. I'm an Indian American. I'm proud of it. But I think we should have this debate. Black, white doesn't matter.
I think we should have this debate
on the content
should,
of the
if
ideas.
If you're going to do it, you should do it in an honest way and in a fair way. And what you're doing is not an honest and fair way. Okay? We appreciate you coming on.
With
thank
due
you
respect, Don, I look forward to continuing that conversation. Thank you.
The conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you
so much. Thank you, Papa.
All right, so let's unpack this. All right, now, first of all, if the New York Times is saying that interview was part of the reason why he got fired, that's weak as hell. Now, what's also crazy, if you actually saw the whole deal, Don was not trying to even be in the conversation. Poppy kept asking if he wanted to say something. He was like, nah, I'm good. And then he finally did. Damn, in hindsight, probably wanted to stay quiet. I think probably what pissed them off was that comment, whatever ethnicity you are, okay? If you just listen to the interview and how they think in terms of how the folks at CNN, how they operate, that could have been seen as dismissive, all right? But here's what I need people to understand. And whenever these things happen and these firings and stuff like that, I love how, like, even during the whole Dominion deal, everybody kept talking about how powerful the power that the Fox News host had, that Sean Hannity had, the power Tucker Carlson had, how they were even more powerful than their bosses, CEO Suzanne Scott. Y'all heard me say this when we talk about athletes. Ooh, LeBron, he's the most powerful NBA player. Do y'all see the shirt I got on? It says Black owned. The only people, see, take that part off. the only people who got power are the people with the own part. It don't matter if Tucker was getting $12, $15 million a year. It don't matter if Don was getting $3, $4, $5, $6 million, whatever he was getting. It doesn't matter that Jeff Schell was a CEO and he made $21 million last year. All three of them, employees. And I keep telling y'all, employees can't get fired. Owners can't get fired. Now, owners can voluntarily step down. They can resign. They can retire. They don't get fired. Rupert could turn the company over to his sons. He still owns the stock. So I need y'all to understand, it was a target on Don's back from the moment Warner took over the company. John Malone said it. Y'all, this real clear. Now Don, y'all got Don's statement? Pull it up. Don released a statement to the press where he said, I was terminated. I was informed this morning by my agent that I have been terminated by CNN. I am stunned. After 17 years at CNN, I would have thought that someone in management would have had the decency to tell me directly. At no time was I ever given any indication that I would not be able to continue to do the work I have loved at the network. It is clear that there are some larger issues at play. With that said, I want to thank my colleagues and the many teams I have worked with for an incredible run. They're the most talented journalists in the business, and I wish them all the best. Now, Don been there 17 years. The folks at CNN PR did issue a statement with regards to Don's statement. Go to my iPad. They said, Don Lemon's statement about this morning's events is inaccurate. He was offered an opportunity to meet with management, but instead released a statement on Twitter. Let me say this again, y'all. It was a bullseye on his back. When he got moved from prime time to the morning, that wasn't no promotion. He went from having a show where he was the host to a show with three other hosts. One that got no business being there on the set, Caitlin Collins. She ain't ready. She ain't ready for prime time. She not, okay? She way too green, okay? She need to go back and get some more experience, okay? So you had all these instances. The Nikki Haley comment, past prime, big screw up, okay? But the deal is, Bullseye was there. Y'all, all the stories you saw drop, the Variety story, the story over the weekend saying White House Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre wouldn't appear on the show with him, chose to do the anchor, interview with anchor with somebody else. Karine, they released a statement saying Karine denies that. Y'all, all those stories came from inside CNN. And so I'm just trying to explain to y'all, you got to be aware of what's going on. Tucker, Tucker didn't learn nothing from Bill O'Reilly. See, Rupert like, damn, I just paid $787.5 million. I spent $32, $35, $40 million on settlements for Bill O'Reilly. Now I'm going to have to spend another $10, $15, $20 million on this other woman because of Tucker. Yeah, your ass got to go. Y'all, employees ain't got no power. They will bounce your ass in a heartbeat, and it don't matter. And so there are all these people who are mad, who are upset. Y'all, that's what they do. It was 10 years ago, April 5th, or April 6th, I think it was April 5th. It was 10 years ago, April 5th, where was my last day at CNN. That was 10 years ago. And see, here's the whole deal. You know the game. I told somebody this, y'all, I joined CNN in 2007. Do y'all know when I plotted my exit from CNN? The day I joined in 2007. Let me say it again. I started planning my exit the day I started. Those jobs ain't guaranteed. Hell, Disney this week is beginning their second round of layoffs. They will lay folks off in a heartbeat. So understand, what you saw is that actions will beget actions. That's what's going on here.
All right, folks, back to that Roadblock Unfiltered video in just one moment.
When you talk about blackness,
and what happens in black culture. We're about covering these things that matter to us, speaking to our issues and concerns.
This is a genuine people powered movement.
There's a lot of stuff that we're not getting. You get it, and you spread the word.
We wish to plead our own cause too long have others spoken for us. We cannot tell our own story if we can't pay for it.
This is about covering us.
Invest in black-owned media.
Your dollars matter. We don't have to keep asking them to cover our stuff.
So please support us in what we do, folks. We want to hit 2,000 people, $50 this month, raise $100,000. We're about.
Yes, folks, Don Lemon is past tense at CNN. Don Lemon is now just a memory. But if you thought that was all, back in the United Kingdom, the Bank of England this past week told United Kingdom citizens to get accustomed to accepting that they're poorer now than ever before. And with inflation and recession hanging as it is now, and the government and government workers at loggerheads over wages, at a time when the value of the British pound is decreasing, the future, the Bank of England says, looks bleak for the United Kingdom. Meanwhile, if the United Kingdom government thought its woes were over, teachers in Britain this past Friday, day before yesterday, announced that they are prepared to go on strike for the next new school term, joining nurses, doctors, emergency health workers, immigration officers, and other government employees in essential services who are begging and have been begging since last year for their wages to be brought up to date with inflation as prices continue to rise and more people get poorer in Great Britain. And while all of that is happening, there are also those who feel that the Rishi Sunak administration is more interested in attracting foreign investment than promoting local business. Watch, listen, and lighten up with this next special feature about the other United Kingdom, some other citizens of the UK are seeing, but Prime Minister Sunak just cannot see. Wepuko.
Looking for somewhere to invest your legitimately earned billions? Why not choose the United Kingdom? As the slowest growing economy in the Western world, including Russia, we're desperate for your money and we'll let you do literally anything with it. You'll pay little or no tax, and with our famous bailouts, any money you do lose, we will cover it. Concerned that you'll be unable to buy your way into political power and influence public policy with your private wealth? Fear not. We're rapidly climbing the corruption index, and we've got Qatar in our sights. Anxious you'll get bad news coverage? It's fine. The world-renowned British press only focus on what really matters. We've set up our political system so that there's no true socialist representation. So, whoever's in power, your money is safe from anyone who might misguidedly suggest you use any of it to improve living standards in the United Kingdom. And we'll let you make record-breaking profits, even if a few old people have to die in their cold homes. Looking to launder your cash? We'll let you buy up huge swathes of our capital city, and you can keep those luxury flats empty, so you'll never be bothered by troublesome tenants. We've made sure that the famously apathetic British people won't be angry at you because they're too busy fighting each other or working out how to buy food and keep warm. Worried they'll eventually figure it all out and rise up against you? No need to. We've banned all that. Invest in the United Kingdom because we'll let you do whatever the fuck you want.
And moving on to serious business after that bit of light fun, we regret to announce the death this past week of two top entertainers in the United States of America. On April 25th, the world went into shock last Tuesday on learning the death many of us in St. Lucia learned of it while watching the budget being presented in the House by the Prime Minister. But on Tuesday, April 25th, the world went into shock on learning of the death of the late, great Harry Belafonte. And 2 days later, just 2 days later, came the news that Jerry Springer also died. Both were in advanced age. Both died quietly. Both died at their homes. And both will be long remembered. Jerry Springer for his shows and Harry for his real story as both an entertainer and an activist. We all know what we remember both and each of them for. So let's today share some tributes. First, in this upcoming video from today on tributes to Jerry Springer.
A ringmaster, his namesake show that ran for nearly three decades, an all-out circus that always brought the shock factor. Outrageous, provocative.
And I know the guy that she's cheating on you with.
Who?
Oh, it's me, bro.
And ratings gold. Springer describing the appeal during its peak here on Today.
It's the craziest show on television. I don't pretend that it's anything but that. But it's entertaining. People obviously like it. We're seeing people that we're not used to seeing on television before.
What began as an ordinary talk show in 1991 soon became must-see TV.
Let's try and do it without hitting each other, okay?
Those infamous brawls and bizarre confrontations captivating audiences. By the late 90s, the Jerry Springer Show became one of America's biggest guilty pleasures, and even for a stretch, surpassing daytime queen Oprah in viewers. But not everyone was a fan.
If people don't like it, and there are many people who don't, that's why God gave us remote control. Turn the station.
Over the years, Springer repeatedly defended his controversial show against critics that called it low class and low brow.
But we're all alike. We're not better than these people. We just dress better.
Springer first made a name for himself in politics. He was elected to the Cincinnati City Council and later became mayor in 1977. But after an unsuccessful run for Ohio governor, Springer turned to broadcasting, starting out as a local reporter and eventually to the anchor desk. But it was his pioneering talk show that launched Springer into pop culture history.
No one's watching because of me. They're watching because the stories are crazy and the people are outrageous.
Through 27 seasons of his own hit show and hosting gigs on dozens of others, Jerry became synonymous with on-screen drama. But those who knew him best say he was always kind and simply loved people.
He was probably the most authentic person that I've ever worked with in this business.
This morning, as tributes pour in, so many now remembering the TV Titan and his signature final thoughts on every show.
Till next time, take care of yourself and each other.
Springer passed away after battling pancreatic cancer. He was 79 years old. Springer's family saying his loss hurts immensely, but memories of his intellect, heart, and humor will live on.
That was about what Jerry Springer himself called the craziest show on earth. I'm sure many of you will agree. Now, let's go to Harry Belafonte, of whom there are so many tributes right now as we speak that we won't have time to even start sharing. So, as per usual, we've selected what we think would be good enough. And in that case, we've selected the following video to share with you today about this American-born man of Caribbean heritage, claimed by both Trinidad and Tobago and Jamaica for his contribution to calypso music and to Caribbean tourism, and as the first singer on Earth, the first singer on planet Earth to sell 1 million copies of an album. Hear it all from Harry himself in this item from PBS NewsHour in an interview that he had done with PBS News Hour. Harry Belafonte.
And finally tonight, a giant in the world of performance and activism has died. We look at the breadth and the impact of Harry Belafonte, whom the president today called a groundbreaking American who used his talent, his fame, and his voice to help redeem the soul of our nation.
Six and seven and eight and punch. Daylight come and if you want go.
It was Harry Belafonte's signature hit in a long career and life defined by much more than music. Belafonte rose to fame with the 1956 Banana Boat Song, earning him the nickname King of Calypso. Born in Harlem to Caribbean parents, he grew up in poverty during the Depression, but went on to win Emmy, Grammy, Oscar, and Tony Awards.
Ever since the world began, woman was always fooling man.
Singing everything from Calypso to spirituals to protest songs. His third album, Calypso, was the first officially certified album by a solo performer to sell more than a million copies.
Don't be like that, baby.
Belafonte broke barriers on the stage and screen as well. One of few black leading men in the 1950s and unafraid of tackling taboo themes like race. Even in a racially segregated America, the handsome, husky-voiced Belafonte became a sex symbol with fans nationwide. But he grew tired of acting, eventually turning down jobs he described as racially neutered. By the 1960s, he was publicly more politically active. In 2011, he spoke about that journey with Gwen Ifill.
My activism really started the day of my birth. Born from immigrant parents in New York City, my mother was overwhelmed by America. She came here with hopes and ambitions that were never fulfilled.
Belafonte recalled the spirit of 1930s America.
At that time, there was a lot of talk about white supremacy and Hitler and democracy, and America was mobilizing for this great campaign, and the whole world was caught up in it. And what attracted me to the arts was the fact that I saw theater as a social force, as a political force. I kind of felt that art was a powerful tool, and that's what I should be doing with mine.
Belafonte lent his voice to the black-led civil rights movement, marching alongside his friend Martin Luther King Jr. He reflected on the first moment he met Dr. King in this 2018 interview with NewsHour's Charlene Hunter Gault.
I listened to him, and I was just absolutely struck with the way in which he presented his case to the black religious community, condemning them for being not more engaged in the social destiny of black people.
As civil rights protests unfolded in 1968, Belafonte guest hosted The Tonight Show for a week.
I'll tell you something, Senator.
The first black man ever to host a late night show. His guests included Dr. King and Bobby Kennedy. His activism over decades knew no bounds.
Of the fight for freedom.
Campaigning to end apartheid in South Africa. Mobilizing support to end HIV/AIDS. And serving as a goodwill ambassador for UNICEF. In 1985, he helped to gather global superstars to record We Are the World. The song raised $64 million for famine relief in Ethiopia. Belafonte also faced criticism for meeting with leftist leaders like Fidel Castro of Cuba and Hugo Chavez of Venezuela. But he never stopped speaking out against racism in America.
The struggle is still going on. The cruelty of the enemy is as great as ever.
And he criticized Democrats and Republicans along the way. In 2006, calling then President George W. Bush the greatest terrorist in the world for invading Iraq. Belafonte carried his mission to promote peace well into his later years, reflecting on his work and life in 2011.
Eleanor Roosevelt just walked into my life, and she turned it around. Dr. King called me on the phone one day. Malcolm X knocked at the door one day. Nelson Mandela, he and I had an exchange of letters while he was in prison. And just these things kept emerging, and each time I saw opportunity to become involved in what their struggle and our struggle was about, and felt I'd make as big a difference as I could.
Belafonte's publicist said he died of congestive heart failure today at his home in New York. He was 96 years old.
And there you saw and heard from the two men Harry Belafonte and before him Jerry Springer about themselves. Dying 2 days from each other, Belafonte at 96 and Springer at 79. Yes, I think I have them right. Belafonte at 96 and Springer at 79, both kicking their respective proverbial buckets at home with members of the family at the bedsides. And while we're at the issue of hearing popular men tell their own stories, our next video is about a man we all knew, who we all remembered just 2 weeks ago, but one who never got to tell us about himself, as he was always too busy telling us about others. The man we're about to hear from lived and died with much admiration. And working out who he really was and what he really achieved is still a work in progress for many, and one that will never end for many more. Mes amis, l'autre vidéo nous, c'est Assou. Un homme, nous tout qu'a échangé et quoi nous te connaître, mais nous pas jamais fini copain. Jik Jordi, c'est un homme qui toujours dit nous tout bagaille sur tout d'autres monde, excepté Koy. L'autre jour, nous t'en enchaîné à ce qui monde, l'autre monde, te quoi itéye, qui monde, l'autre monde, te quoi itéye, mais Jordi a. Nous avons lui-même parlé à son manière et de mission à la terre. Here, folks, is Brother George Odlum, speaking to fellow advocate David Hines back between 1979 and 1980 when he served as St. Lucia's Minister for Foreign Affairs. Brother George, as St. Lucia's Minister for Foreign Affairs. And this interview is over 4 decades old, but it's sure to revive previous memories for many. Oui, mes amis, c'est plaisir nous pour baou Brother George depuis 43 ans qui passé. Mais c'est même Brother George là nous te connaître, mais peut-être nous partir connaître les et comprendre à ce moment-là. Nous caïtenni à présent. Here's George, me, Brother George.
We're here on the beautiful island of St. Lucia. We'll talk today about St. Lucian foreign policy, education in St. Lucia, politics in general. And our special guest is the Foreign Minister of St. Lucia, Mr. George Odlum. So don't go anywhere. Carib Nation is up next. Welcome to Carib Nation. My name is David Hines. We are here in St. Lucia, the country that has produced 2 Nobel Prize winners, Sir Arthur Lewis and most recently Derek Walcott, the playwright and poet. We are going to talk today with the Foreign Minister of St. Lucia, Mr. George Odlum, who is no stranger to politics. Mr. Odlum has been involved in St. Lucian politics since the 1960s. Of course, we're going to touch on various issues, even though we're going to concentrate on foreign policy. Foreign Minister George Odlum, welcome to Carib Nation.
Thank you.
Let me ask you a relatively difficult question to begin with. Do you think foreign policy is still important for small states like St. Lucia?
Even more important now than it was before, in view of the globalization. It's a question that whether you should be left out of the globalization completely. Sometimes when I look at the trading blocs arranging themselves, I want to say, stop the world, we want to get off, because it looks so structured against small states. But we have come to the conclusion in CARICOM that we have to get in there with the process. And recently we've seen the benefits of that. The fact that you have a voice internationally and the CARICOM voice can be pretty strong, because most of the leaders of the country, of the countries of the CARICOM, are fairly articulate people who could put the points of view well. And they carry a voice out of all proportion to their size in the councils of the world. So I think it's very important that we stay in there and see if we could keep reminding the developed world that the process of globalization, that chain will be as strong as its weakest link. And in that, we'll see whether we could get some consideration. I was about to say protection, but I changed the word because, you know, the WTO now and the whole thrust of liberalization of trade is to stop the protection. So we have to find a way of living with that.
Make the connection for me between foreign policy, between all these international meetings that you would attend. Make the connection between those meetings and the lives of the ordinary St. Lucians, the ordinary Caribbean person, the farmer, the peasant, the worker. Make the connection.
All right, well, the recent action of the World Trade Organization tells you immediately that everything the farmer does and the arrangement of the market and everything is determined now by international rules of trade, adjudicated on by the World Trade Organization. So these large meetings take decisions that have direct consequence on the farmer and on the small person in small communities too. It is seen now that in order to develop any nation, you have to develop the whole area, so that they're not the inequities which bring about trouble and sometimes even revolution. So the approach is to tackle the whole hemisphere. And I was amazed to see that there were plans to have complete primary education in the entire hemisphere, 100% by a certain date. I think it's 2010.
Do you think such a plan would be beneficial to a small country like St. Lucia?
Extremely, because although Sir Arthur Lewis said some time ago, with a lot of validity, that the cure for poverty is not money, but education, right? That education cost a lot of money. And beyond the scope and the capability of a lot of the small territories. So if we included in a block arrangement like that, the funding and capitalization will be a bit easier. But my problem is that we might have to fine-tune our education so that although we do the broad things like primary education for all, secondary education for all, we must fine-tune it so that the local conditions, the culture, could be reflected, and we could still produce Nobel laureates, even though we're in that broad system.
Do you think that the conditions here are conducive to that transformation of the education system? Of course, we are out of independence now for almost 2 decades, but by and large in the Caribbean, what we have retained to this day is the same kind of colonial educational structures. And it seems to me that if we're going to do what you're talking about, we'll have to really tackle the thing at the structure level. Comment on that for me.
Very true. I think one of the things that I admire Cuba most for was the fact that they got down to grips with the illiteracy problem, and within 5 or 6 years, they'd wiped it out completely. I feel a lot of us in the Caribbean have failed in that we didn't follow that pattern. And so illiteracy is still hanging around, 40% in some countries, a little higher in others. Now, I think that is the basis for starting the educational transformation. But after that, we have to think of education as local. I think it's Walcott who once said that our job is Adam's task of naming things. So our education should start with an identification of the immediate environment, a description of it, an appreciation of its qualities, and move out from there into a regional thing, and probably then link up internationally. So the point I'm making here is that the education cannot be superimposed by a colonial power. It must start out of the local experience. Only the local is real.
On my way here to St. Lucia on the plane, I was reading a series of articles by George Lamin, Rex Neckleford, and Michael Manley, in which they were talking about the whole issue of culture and its relationship to education. And of course, you know, George Lamin is very big on cultural imperialism and so on, and the need for an indigenous form of education that is rooted in the culture of the Caribbean. Talk about the relationship between St. Lucian and Caribbean culture and this new educational thrust that you mentioned just now.
Yes, well, you have called names of people who have been ringing that bell in the Caribbean for a few years now. Mercifully, because we had all fancy ideas of what education was, but education must come out of the total cultural experience, and it must teach us not to learn things by rote, but to develop a kind of deductive system where we could reason, and the reasoning must come out of our experience and out of an appreciation of other universal principles. So the emphases must change, because the children who came out of our colonial schools, they learned, as Virginia I. Paul would say, like mimic men. They just parroted what people said, sometimes without even understanding it. The approach to their education must be different now. It must teach them to understand and teach them to look at premises and arrive at conclusions from these premises. So it's a process of reasoning rather than stuffing education into a head, as they say. Especially now with information is so available with the internet and the computer now that there's less reliance on cramming and learning things. If you can get the information at the press of a button, then there's almost no use to store it. But the more vital part of the process is the reasoning process. We should produce a kind of citizen that is able to solve problems. I'm not talking about nuclear problems or problems of existence in philosophy, but he must be able in his normal life to use the educative process to bring to bear on the problems that confront him, as simple as they might seem, and arrive at solutions from them. Then we are producing a man within the totality of his environment.
Some people have said that government need to get out of education and that the private sector should get into education. How react to that?
Well, I have a reservation about this total involvement of the private sector, because our problem in these islands is getting the surplus redistributed. And the private sector, like most private sectors, are there very often to turn the profit, to make the surplus, but the distribution becomes dodgy. I still feel that the government must have a hand in the distribution, shaping where the schools go, that everybody gets things evenly. That is my reservation about that type of education. If the government has a broad policy of looking after everybody equitably, it is more of a guarantee that the education would be well distributed than if it was farmed out to private sector. This is a reservation I have about that.
There is a feeling, Mr. Odlum, that the state as we know it, the government as we know it, is becoming less and less important in the process of development. Some people have talked about the withering away of the state, not in Marxian terms, but certainly in terms of the downplaying of the role of the state in the affairs of the country. First of all, have you seen a minimizing of the role of the state? And the second question is, do you think that the state really ought to get out of a number of these areas?
Yes, I think a lot of what is happening now is a realization that a government can't work the total magic that needs to be worked. And people are finding that they have to fall back on their own resources. And in past, we perceived the government as, you know, the arbiter of all decisions and the holder of power. And that power is not often used as it should be. So the people are coming to an awareness now that they should depend less on the government. And the recent development of groups like the NGOs and other organizations means that there's a feeling that the people and the individuals have to depend more on themselves and less on government. That's not a bad thing. However, I feel that there's a cyclical development to this. It builds up, and if the bureaucracy gets oppressive, then there's a movement to divest and to let decision-making go more to the periphery. But the other thing happens sometimes. If it's divested too widely, then there's the need for pulling it in together. So it all depends on the balance of power that one could achieve in any particular state.
Let's go back to foreign policy. You were foreign minister in the last Labour government, 1979 to 1982. And of course, before you became foreign minister in this new Labour government, you did a stint at the United Nations as their ambassador for St. Lucia. What has changed in terms of foreign policy and foreign policy thrust in the Caribbean and the world at large since 1979, 82 and the present?
Well, the most obvious change is the Cold War. Mm-hmm. In 1979, we were preoccupied with the Cold War and the West versus Russia. And the West saw in every single movement the encroachment of Russia and Cuba. And the Caribbean became a theater of war in a way in which the two powers were fighting. Now, with the collapse of that, now it's a little freer in the sense that it's polarized more in the direction of trade. Now, in some ways, the trade war is as vicious as the political war, in that the large countries are really going to consolidate their markets and to look after themselves, and the small countries must really get in there and establish their existence, if nothing else, and see if they could help to define the process of liberalization. So that is a large shift. Right now, foreign policy is trade policy, and trade policy is foreign policy. So this is a sizable shift away from 1979.
And of course, economic diplomacy will mean that your foreign policy workers, your foreign policy strategists and technicians must take cognizance of this new change. Are you doing any kind of training in that area to get your workers and your foreign policy workers oriented to economic diplomacy?
Well, there's a lot more going on now than went on before in that sense, because the sheer weight of conducting a foreign policy for a small Caribbean country is colossal, because you need to have a presence in the United Nations, you need to have a Washington presence, you need to look at all the Latin American states and see what's going on in Mercosur and the Andean Pact, and you need to have people out there. The Asian tigers were developing, and you need to look out there too. Africa is still a sleeping giant, as they say, and we all hope that within the next century they'll stop sleeping. And so you have to look at what's happening in Johannesburg, what's happening in West Africa too. So it's incumbent upon small states to keep their eye open in all these areas. Now that calls for straight economics. You have to virtually decide of how much representation you could have vis-a-vis how much fertilizer you'll give to your farmers,
right,
or bread to your people. So these decisions are vital, and we're getting as much training as we can in those areas. Now diplomacy doesn't turn on a good handshake, a smile, and a drink. It's more hard-nosed now. It's what you could get and what it cost you.
George Odlum, the Foreign Minister of St. Lucia, speaking here on a wide range of issues that affect the St. Lucia and the Caribbean.
And this is all the time we have for today's show, which we hope you enjoyed. I'm Earl Bousquet, inviting you to join us again next Sunday, May the 7th, for the 7th edition of Earl at Large in our 8th year, on air, on your screen, anytime, and on your device, everywhere on the DBS app. For now, pour présent, et por el momento, adios, hasta luego, cheche, goodbye, et bye bye tout le monde, od ul a guacord.